So a very good evening to all our viewers. Today I have a very interesting and a special guest. He's Shahz Mehmood. I'm happy to have him on the show. Welcome, Shahz.
Thank you, Vamshi, for calling me today.
Yes. So tell me, how was the schooling experience? I think we got disconnected towards 11th and 12th grade.
Correct. That was correct. The time. I think that's when, you know, of course, my journey has been with HPS.
Yeah.
You were with Gitanjali. Right? So the rival schools which we used to claim back then, even now, there's the funny war about the school across the Nala.
Yeah.
We call that to Gitanjali, Gitanjali calls that to us. Yeah.
I don't really understand that whole rivalry, but
That's so I think after school, 11th and 12th happened in HPS itself, after 10 years in HPS. You know, I was wondering what I should be doing.
Mm.
And I used to be limitedly involved with my father's business, rather my ancestral business of limestone mining in the Gulbarga district of now Karnataka, back then Hyderabad, in Wadi. And being the fifth generation child involved in that business, I was but asked to be involved with it. And I mean, a business 100 years old is bound to have many legal complications and land issues and disputes and everything. So I was very confused as to what to study, and I was pushed into going and doing law.
Law, okay.
So I joined Tasmania Law College. Of course, I wanted to join Government Law College, Bombay, because that was, I remember in 2006, the second best college in India. And they only had a system of admitting through your 12th grades. I remember I had a distinction grade, but the cutoff was some 96%, which was unheard of back then. Yeah. You know?
And with the lifestyle in HPS.
And with the lifestyle which we had in HPS. Nothing which discounted that. We did fairly well.
Yeah.
But I think there was a lot of reservations, 50% for Maharashtrians, 50% outside. In that also there was various reservations. So therefore, as a young child, I was very disturbed by these whole.
But why do you went into law? What was the?
Because you know, back then when we had to get into, I mean, all I heard was and all I saw my father for the last 15 years of growing up was court cases, land disputes, mining issue disputes. There's bound to have problems. Mm. I mean. I remember when I joined the company in 2006 while studying law in Usmania, 68 court cases across various courts, from high courts to the district courts to the trial courts.
Wow.
And all I did was I used to go sit with the lawyers there and I used to learn from them. And over the course of 6-7 years, I brought down those 64 cases to some 8 odd cases, winning each one of them. Whether it was at trial level, whether it was at appeal level, whether it was at high court appeal, you know, division
bench
level. That's
a great achievement, by the way. I mean, I keep dealing with whatever little cases and I know what hell that is.
It's difficult. Wow. I mean, and I remember that it had reached a time when, you know, people had gotten aware of the value of land.
Mm.
These was a large chunk of mining land, unfenced.
Okay.
You had people entering into those lands. You had people you know, changing the records in the department. The company was in a mess, mismanaged over many decades. So when I got involved, it was literally, do you want this or should we just sell it lock, stock and barrel?
Oh, wow. Okay.
And I said, no. I mean, obviously, I want to keep it. I want to do something with it.
Let me try my bit.
Let me try my bit. So I gave that company 8 years. I'm still a part of that company. Literally dug up records sitting in, I still remember going and living in the house in Wadi, which is about 100 years old, and a lot of friends have memories there because I used to always, some friends used to tag along.
Okay.
And we used to always spend the, our weekends there, or you know, it was 4 hours from here by drive. So we would go there and I would wake up in the morning. I would head out to the tehsil office or to the lawyers or to some department to resolve issues, because that was what I had to do. To keep a company running is what I had to resolve issues. I saw the larger picture that it's limestone reserves. Perhaps it's the only chunk of limestone reserves left in that belt, which is not been acquired by a cement company. So my mission was to consolidate everything and then sell it at a good valuation.
Okay, okay.
Unlike what distress value they were getting. But as the litigations got resolved, sales tax issues, they were, you name the issue, it was there. I mean, you're in business, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Every day we wake up to a different issue.
Yeah.
I remember still waking up in the morning and going to the Taisildar's office. Have your breakfast at 5, 6 o'clock. We used to wake up, have our breakfast, head out to the Tehsil office, be there by 9:30, 10. Figure out a way with the Tehsil records room.
To get into that,
to get the records as to how we acquired this land. There was no record. It was just like, it was in those old days, you know, this is all our land.
Yeah, yeah.
What is the survey?
Wherever you
what
see
is the extent? Who owns it? Remember, I used to wear gloves, cover my face with a cloth, get into those dusty record rooms and spend hours and hours, you know, tip that guy a little bit saying, don't go for lunch and sit with me because you'll be able to pull it out. Took me many years, but managed to consolidate a company, brought it to a certain valuation.
Very nice. So a hardcore experience of on-ground management, right?
On-ground managing, on-ground managing multiple people of different
backgrounds,
whether it was the locals, and they didn't want us there. We were Hyderabadis at the end of the day. They did not want us there.
Okay.
They learned the value of the land. They learned the value of the mineral. So they wanted us out from there.
Okay.
Unfortunately, the only case we lost was a mining lease classification issue of our lease, which was 60 years old.
Okay.
They classified the mineral as a minor mineral and therefore rejected the lease on our land. It was not government land, it was our land. The lease. So now that case has been sitting in the Supreme Court.
Okay.
You know, once you go to the Supreme Court, it takes forever. It's been 7 years.
7 years.
That case has been sitting, waiting
still
for
a short
final
time.
Hearing, still a short time. But I'm hoping 2019 is the year I win that case, and I'm able to go back and do something with that asset which I've kind of consolidated over the years.
Very nice.
So that was my journey with Wadi. I mean, 2006 to 2012, almost till 14.
Okay.
And one thing I realized that my grandfather, my father all put their eggs in one basket. And I said, I need to do something more. I need to have something. So in 2012, I went around looking.
Okay.
What should I be doing? So at that time, the idea of rather than selling this asset as a lock, stock and barrel, the idea was let us perhaps put up a cement factory there. So I must be perhaps the youngest guy. I was all of 2012, 13. I would have been, what, 23, 24.
Yeah.
We went in, we floated a company. Okay. Went and got the license, a single window clearance license for a 2.5 million cement plant.
Wow. Okay.
And I said, I need to know the cement business. So I took off. At that time, Lafarge Cement was opening a plant in Wadi.
Okay.
So we happened to host them for a lunch in our house there, where we'd invited the various leaders of the Congress and the BJP and everybody, the leaders of the village,
local.
Because they wanted help.
Yeah.
They were not being able to start their factory.
Okay.
So we'd invite them. So I had gotten to know the CMD of Lafarge at that time.
Okay.
So I went and I asked him, I said, we are also thinking of doing something like this. I don't have the net worth, I don't have the money, I don't have anything. We have this asset, but what I want is even if I go to a person to give me an investment or to bring them on board, I need to know how cement is made. Can you give me an internship? So in January of 2012, I took off to Bombay.
Okay.
And I worked in Lafarge Cements for 3 to 4 months in their corporate office.
Okay.
After 6 years of being on field, I hated every bit of it. I hated sitting in the AC office. I hated sitting looking at a screen.
Desk job.
And I was a kind, if you gave me work, I would finish it then and there. You know, sit through the night if required, finish it. I still remember the first assignment I was given was to plot all the cement factories on the India map,
okay,
with their capacities, okay, for that year, 2012. Mm. I sat through 3 nights and I finished it. I went and I gave it to my boss then.
Mm.
And he's like, "Arey, why have you finished this so fast?" I said, "What do you mean finished it so fast?"
Yeah.
He's like, "Listen, we've planned your internship. We don't have work if you finish it. I thought you'll take 10 days to finish this.
Okay.
You finished this in 3 days.
Mm.
So please go slow.
Go and go back and do it in 10 days and come."
I was, after I think 2-3 months of doing various things, I worked in corporate affairs, worked in HR, worked in accounts, worked in business development, went through the entire cycle of understanding how this corporate office works. And I said, "I don't need to know this. I want to know how cement is manufactured."
Mm.
So I walked in, I remember, and I said, "Listen, please send me to the factory." They were like, "Why would you go to the factory? You know, you've come from CMD's reference. How are you going to the factory?" I said, "But I want to go to the factory and know how it's done." So this is okay, fine, please go. Yeah. Took off, took a flight, went to Raipur.
Okay.
And from Raipur, it was another 2-3 hours drive to this factory called Arasmeta,
okay,
which was owned by the Raymonds,
okay,
and sold and acquired by Lafarge.
Okay.
And lived on the factory, was given your goggles, your shoes, your helmet, your jacket.
Interesting, right?
I mean, fascinating.
Mm.
I mean, learned how the quarry worked, how this captive power plant worked, how they manufacture the clinker to how it's ground and made into cement, packaging units.
So it's a very elaborate procedure.
It's a huge procedure. I mean, it's a mega industry.
Yeah.
To learn how it is to live on a plant.
Yeah.
Where there is nothing around but a small kirana shop.
It's worse than a university town. Yeah.
And from there, we went to another plant after 10-15 days, went to Sonadi, which was the Tata owned plant bought by Lafarge. Okay. So I lived there for a bit. Much larger plant. They just, I remember, they just put a Chinese line.
Okay.
Which they just put in there, and there were all these delegates from China who'd come down. And the biggest problem, they said, "We don't understand what the machines are saying. It's all in Cantonese, the language, in Mandarin. We don't know what it's saying." And they needed people to translate it.
That's so a classic problem.
So that machine was just not working. Yeah. That line was breaking down and it takes 7 days to fire up that kiln.
Okay.
So they were bleeding money there.
Mm.
And then after I finished the plant, I kind of realized, of course, I had my whole book, which I had noted down various notings of each thing I learned there. And then I came back and I told Dad, "Let's really move on this cement."
Yeah.
And then, of course, this problem happened where we got stuck in the Supreme Court. So, yeah, so that was my early journey while doing studying law at the same time. So, I'd finished law by 2011. So, therefore, I had a chance to go intern with Lafarge.
So, it's quite a interesting journey until you came back, I suppose.
Very interesting.
The whole learning process. I had something similar in my first job experience as well, where in Sambalpur, it's a place in Orissa. So the whole process was go to the factory in the morning, come back in the evening, just eat dinner and sleep.
So frustrating.
It is.
And we've always lived in HPS. We had 500 friends around us.
It did really test, I don't know, I think living alone, the whole concept of how to, you know, not do anything but work. It was quite a load full, I must say. But anyway, so then you came back to Hyderabad, and then?
So actually, while I was in Lafarge in Bombay, so after I finished the 3-4 months in Bombay, 2 months at the factory, then back in Bombay, right? I was there for a month to close up the internship. So we were at a family dinner at Olive at Mahalakshmi.
Okay.
With, of course, my uncle Edie, all of us, we were sitting at a family dinner. I told him, I said, "Why don't you think of Hyderabad?" Because that thought in my mind kept playing about diversifying. What if something goes wrong?
Okay.
Let's diversify. Let's have something else. And something which I did, right? You wanted to do something.
Of course. What's your value addition to
it? So I sat with him and I kind of told him, I said, "Why don't you think of Hyderabad?" And he said, "I came to Hyderabad a few years back. It's not ready." I said, "Come now. See it. I'll show it to you." He said, "Sure." And I think a month later, he came down to Hyderabad. He was here for some dinner at Falaknuma from birthday party which he'd come down for. So I took him out, showed him a couple of restaurants.
Hmm.
And he said, wow, Hyderabad has changed.
Hmm.
I said, yes, I think it's ready for an olive.
Yeah.
So he said, sure, but I'll only do it if, you know, there is a level of partnership, because otherwise a new city is very difficult to open a F&B business in. So we said, sure, let's think about it. And he said, I'm ready to talk last quarter of this year.
Okay.
So it took me that much time to go sort out other things and everything. Studying. I was still busy with Wadi and I was in and out. I remember you know Salman, right? So Salman and I were talking about this, and Salman said, "Arey, I'm very interested."
Mm.
But then Salman got very busy with his workshop, which he had just opened then. So Salman said, "Arey, Shiraz is there.
Mm.
He's also a lawyer. He's also finished. And I've known Shiraz because he was my senior in school.
Yeah, yeah.
And we've known the family. So I said, "Chalo, Shiraz, what do you think?" So Shiraz was very excited.
Mm.
I remember 1st of October, I wrote a mail to AD saying we're looking for properties now.
Mm.
And we started looking for properties, came across couple which were nice, not nice. Mm. That time to understand those rents, we were getting so irritated because Hyderabad was a small city which paid small rents.
Yeah, yeah.
Anybody and everybody was asking in lakhs, so not understanding it. And then we stumbled upon this property.
Mm.
Where all Random. Is today. In fact, Dad went for a walk and he went into this property.
Okay.
He said, it's a very good property. Why don't you think about it?
Mm.
So we went and saw it, massive property. Mm. We said, why not? So we called down AD. Luckily, AD had seen this property 6 years back, before it had become this.
Okay.
It was that there was some restaurant which was running there, which shut.
Yeah. But it's linked to the government, no? This
it's whole. A tourism property.
Mm. Mm.
So there was a person in the middle who had the lease. Okay. So we went there and we negotiated down with him and we closed it.
Mm.
This was in December, we closed it.
Mm.
And I had no capital, I had no money. I didn't know anything about F&B.
Okay.
So basically, didn't know what this business is. My parents didn't support me, saying, why are you getting into this business? My grandfather was very apprehensive because he said, and my grandfather was my mentor.
Okay.
So he was very apprehensive. It was a very difficult decision to make, but somewhere there was a calling. I said, I need to do this.
Mm.
And more so to prove it to myself that I can do something.
So you went for training?
No training.
Mm.
We just jumped into project management, handling contractors, handling design agencies, handling
the whole show.
The whole show there. And suddenly we are, you know, we've got designs coming in and we have to implement. I knew a little bit of construction. So basically figure out how interiors are done. I've always loved doing interiors, so got into that, sourcing this.
So you added a lot of your style.
Yes, but it was, like, I learned a lot from, it was the brainchild of Vivek Popli and Sabina Singh.
Okay, they are.
So Sabina Singh is a director of the company and she's also AD's wife and my aunt.
Okay.
And Vivek Popli was the architect.
Okay.
Now a very dear friend of mine.
Okay. Good.
So I learned a lot from them, how design is, you know, how one designs a space.
Mm.
But I added my inputs. The windmill you see is completely my thought.
Okay.
You know, I thought of it and I kind of got my carpenters and I kind of drew
this
it.
Random drawing,
Kind of engineered it.
Okay.
There was a lot of learning, errors. I had my contractors, so I knew what the rates were.
Mm.
And I knew where to source the best things from. So I still remember my Jeep.
Mm.
I mean, if you recall, the Jeep is very famous from all our friends and everything. That Willy's Jeep, we used to drive all the way to Rani Ganj and RP Road and Jeep Bazaar to buy all the stuff at, because you had wanted to run a tight
project.
You know.
Whatever you save is earned.
And again, no money, but we not put in any money. And I remember, company was asking for the contribution, but I kept saying, listen, let me figure it out. I'm all but 23 years old. I don't have the money. You all please put it in.
Mm.
I still remember the company used to operate through a bank called Ratnakar Bank. It's a very funny story, which is now RBL Bank.
Oh, okay.
They acquired RBS.
Okay.
So Ratnakar Bank didn't have any office here.
Mm.
I remember they had sent a checkbook signed.
Mm.
Any vendor we would go to, he would be like, what is this bank? I'm not taking this. So we had to convince them, please take this check, let it encash. After it encashes, you give us the material. So it was a difficult period. It was peak summer that year.
Okay.
And
I think I bumped into you during one of these things in
you
Truffles.
You would have.
We used to sit at Truffles. And
correct. We used to sit at Truffles planning. And plan how it's to be done. It was a very interesting journey.
Mm.
How to manage costs, how to manage project costs, to put it all up. And yeah, I mean, I closed the project within the budget.
Great.
And of course, it was a month delay. And in spite of that, we closed it in budget.
Okay.
And we opened Olive. Of course, one of the people who really, I would say I was one of the last few people who were personally trained by AD
okay.
himself how to run a restaurant.
Okay. And I'm sure he has,
I mean, so he has immense experience. He's known as the godfather of F&B
okay.
in India. So I'd learned F&B from him,
and,
you know, food trials and the parties we threw in Hyderabad and it just became the place. And
yeah.
I remember we had so much of problem with competition back then. They blocked our license.
Who was your competition then? What did they
I wouldn't
then?
Name them today
okay.
because they've all kind of
okay.
retired from F&B.
Okay.
But back
so
then they were known as the Big Five.
You made them retire.
I'm not sure whether I make them retire. I would say that I broke open their monopoly.
Okay.
It was, I mean, I was, we were threatened. We were threatened. We had raids.
Okay.
We were picked up.
Oh, wow.
And made to sit harassed.
So how did you manage all of that?
Knowing the law was a big
that
thing.
Helped. Yeah.
I knew law.
Yeah.
I am a very outspoken person.
Hmm.
Somebody pushes me in a corner, I go on head on.
Okay.
It helped. It helped. I had some very well wishers who I could reach out to. And say, listen, these people are harassing me, they're troubling me, and take advice from them. And it worked. And family was disturbed. They were disturbed as to what
I'm
are you
sure.
doing?
Such a young
what
age.
What are you doing? You're
yeah.
23, you're being bullied, something will happen to you. I didn't pay attention. I went head on.
That's the best part
and
about the age also, right?
And yeah, I mean, you have that fire in your...
Yeah.
I still remember going to... I shouldn't be saying it on record, but I went to a department and he was trying to tell me it doesn't work like this. And this is how the law is. I said, is this the law? I went down, I went and bought myself a law book, one of the rules book. And I read through it and I said, show me where does it say? And I threw it on his table and I said, show me where does it say? Do you want money? Tell me what you want. I'll give it to you. And he didn't know, I don't think anybody had spoken it. Sure enough, the file was moved.
Good.
So, yeah, I mean, we faced the issues.
Yeah,
we
yeah.
learned from our mistakes.
What? Tell me about your mistakes. What did you, did you goof up anywhere, anytime?
Lots,
in
lots
terms of,
lots
yeah,
of times.
Is there something where you felt, this was a very good learning lesson for me?
Mistake was, I mean, I'm a person who trusts people very easily.
Okay.
I end up trusting anybody who's around, you know. I sometimes think that, you know, I sometimes feel I'm a lot like what the judiciary imagines, right? You are innocent until proven guilty. And that's where you make mistakes.
Okay.
A very trusted person
okay.
of ours. He was retiring
okay.
from my dad's office. I took him. I said, I used to call him Sahab. And I said, Sahab, you know, you sit.
Help me out in this.
Just sit. You be the supervisor for cashiers. Just sit. Don't do anything. Just sit there in that room. Because I wanted him, I didn't want him to sit at home and not. So I was giving him a salary and, you know, like a retirement work job.
And some trusted guy.
Trusted guy. We've known him for 25 years. I mean, I call him Saab. And one day, my security head came up to me and he showed me a clipping where he was stuffing money in his trousers. I didn't know what to say. And I called him and I said,
what's
made
happening?
Dad speak to him and say, show him this video. He confessed to having siphoned away about close to 70,000-80,000 bucks over 2-3 weeks.
Yeah.
For me, it was one of the biggest learnings in my life that your most closest person can also backstab.
Can also do that, yeah.
You have to keep your guard up all the time.
So in our office, we always say, trust but verify. So it's like, I'm trusting you, but I always have like a checkpoint.
Yeah. So you know, in F&B, you have checkpoints. Right? Yeah. You have checks and balances. Mm. There's always some scope of extra. So whose money was being stolen was the poor kid guy's tips.
Mm. Okay.
Right? Mm. Because that we don't account for, right? That they distribute.
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, once the billings are done and everything, you will have certain surplus which goes in tips.
Mm-hmm.
And that was what was going. And that's how these guys kind of turned around the cameras to keep an eye on him. But yeah, I mean, it was a very interesting journey with, you know, learning about this. And we were alone. We were, like I told you, we were bulldozed and we were harassed.
Yeah.
But what is the biggest happiness which I feel, I mean, I've never spoken about it to anybody, is when I see so many people now in F&B.
Yeah.
A lot of people used to ask me, do you think that's competition? I said, no. I see this as a market which is developed now.
When
we started, people didn't know what al dente pasta was.
Mm.
They would think we are serving them raw pasta. Mm. That's how you eat it.
What kind of marketing did you do? Like, I'm sure like the whole, since it was very nascent right then.
I have not studied marketing.
Mm.
I had no idea about marketing. I got mentored by AD, Candice, who used to work with us, Priyanka Dodd.
Okay.
These were the marketing heads back then in Olive, from making me wear uniform clothes.
Mm.
So there was a phase when I only wore waistcoats.
Yeah, I remember that.
That was choreographed. I mean, it's so funny, but that was how was a brand directive. That you need to have a certain
look.
I had Mukta, who used to handle our public relations.
Okay.
I had Radhika Mishra in Bangalore, who used to scream at me saying, you know, dress in a particular way, sit like this, stand like this.
We were good that you got all that
I
training.
I got that learning. Yeah, I learned all of that. Right? Yeah. I mean, branding agencies, working with them, how branding works, how social. Back then, you know, we still had Facebook groups.
Mm.
There was no pages.
Yeah, yeah.
There was no Instagram. There was nothing when we started.
So you had like Olive Group and you were pushing it.
Yeah. So we learned how social media works. We taught AD how social media works. Okay. We learned it and we taught. So it was trial and error. I mean, I still feel so happy when I see that page of our Olive page in Hyderabad. It had 16,000 organic likes.
Very nice.
Today, if anybody opens a page, they know without spending money, there's no way to bring likes.
Yeah, yeah.
Today, the page is almost 30,000.
Okay.
But back then, there was no Facebook ads. There was no Google ads.
Mm.
So you needed to drive content, post it, share it in certain groups. The blogging community of Hyderabad was disorganized back then. There was only two people. I think there was Nidhi and there was Avinash Gulab.
Okay.
And Sabyasachi Re. And Vijay Marur. There were three or four of them. And they used to write for newspapers, Swati, Suchitra. So all of these people, you know, Mohit, who was with Soda, Chowder Singh, he kind of got everybody together. And the whole blogging culture in Hyderabad started with food. So, it's a nice 6 years of F&B that I've done. We opened up more restaurants. I traveled to other cities to open up more restaurants for the Olive Group.
Okay.
Whether it was, so my credit, I have 9 restaurants openings that I've done.
Okay. Well, tell me about those. What are those?
So Olive here.
Okay.
Then there was the Olive, there was the Soda Bangalore, which we went for. There was Soda Hyderabad. There was the Olive Bistro in Goregaon.
Okay.
I still remember that Olive Bistro in Goregaon in the middle of Oberoi Mall.
Okay.
At 3 in the morning, we got a crane and we lifted a matador onto the third floor.
Wow.
It was unheard of to have a matador truck inside a restaurant. Mm. So that was an interesting stint.
So how do you process all this and how do you get ideas to do something?
So of course, there's a design team and there's an aesthetic team. But one has to practically be there.
Yeah.
I mean, for F&B, one of the things I keep telling people is, you might have a brilliant idea. Don't do it if you're not going to sit and run it.
Yeah.
Don't do it. You'll burn your money.
You have to be hands-on. Yeah.
You have to be there to run F&B. And so after Goregaon,
I think you did Goa as well, right?
Did Goa, did Ek Bar in Delhi, did Hoppery here, did Giggle Water here, did the Ollie in Delhi.
Okay.
So I was involved with many openings and training boys, Ladybug in Bangalore. There was training staff. Olive Goa was the most memorable recently.
Okay. Okay.
Where I still remember a fond memory of the staff on the food trials.
Okay.
Were missing a step.
Okay.
It was two levels. So they were missing a step, and one of them flew with a tray of food onto a guest's lap. Next morning, all of them are blindfolded with a tray with glasses filled to the brim with water to walk around the property so they know where the step
is.
So yeah, there've been fun memories like that. The most vivid memory I have is of a soda opening.
Okay.
Where we've invited 300 guests for the opening party.
Mm.
And at 7 o'clock, the carpenter is trying to fix a toilet paper holder.
Mm.
And he drills into the main water line.
Oh, wow.
Next thing you know, there's 2 inches of water in the entire restaurant and it's gushing out of the toilet. So we had to shut
at
the
seven.
Mains. At 7.
Hmm.
We shut the mains. And instantly frantic calls to everybody. I think it was a Sunday.
Sunday is the worst day to have a problem, man.
Get a cup plumber and we'll pay you triple the cost or whatever. Just come. And I think it just happened that we had Tanveer Nizam.
Okay.
I remember he was, Tanveer was a staff training expert and one of the old senior people in Delhi Olive.
Okay.
So he was here for the opening. So he said, Shahz, go and change.
Mm.
I'll figure it out. We need somebody here to receive the guests. So I went to change and I came back. By the time I came back, there was one plumber working, but the toilets were not functioning and there was no water in the kitchen. Okay. So they went the old school way. They went the old school way. They filled in 3 buckets, one with soap water, one with hot water, and one with rinsing water to wash the vessels. And I think that we were using the building toilets.
Wow.
I think the toilets only got opened up at about
so it's like typical
10 in the night or something.
Jugaad work.
But I mean, there's so many, you know, I can go on with these stories. But yeah, I mean, F&B has been an important part of my life, and now I'm looking at other avenues with food.
Very nice, sir. Tell me about the Hyderabad culture. I was like, and I have to comment that you are looking very handsome in the.
Somebody wise told me that if you're working, just put on a uniform. You'll save so much of time in the morning, and you do.
Okay.
Now that for the last quarter,
I've
taken a back seat from day-to-day working of restaurants because I've put in the teams and they're doing a fabulous job.
Okay.
And I've been concentrating on agro and food processing.
Okay.
I see huge potential in that with millets and a lot of, processed foods.
Yeah.
I have two partners also with me. One is Anandit and Ishan.
Okay.
Two dear friends of mine. We started a company a few 2 years back.
Okay.
So I'm concentrating on that. So that doesn't require me to look glamorous. So somebody said that you waste too much of time in the morning getting ready.
Yeah.
And I said, yeah. And I think my wife also kind of seconded me saying, you waste too much time in front of a mirror.
Finding the right waistcoat.
Finding what to wear, the right waistcoat or the jacket.
Yeah.
So if it's a formal meeting,
yeah,
I end up wearing a suit.
Okay.
Otherwise, you'll often find me in a kurta pajama. It's the easiest thing to wear and get out to work.
So, thank you so much, Shahz. I think I'm definitely sure that the upcoming F&B guys, you know, watching this will definitely get inspired by the various stories that you shared.
I hope them all the best, and I'm always available in case anybody needs any advice with F&B in the city.
I know, I should mention that. You're one of the very few people I know who, even though we are not in touch, just a call away and you're always ready to help.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think that's a great quality.
That's the Hyderabadi tehzeeb.
Yes.
I mean, always there.
Absolutely. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much
for coming down.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay.